Welcome to our lecture today where we explore a wide world of music. My name is Shelly Berg and I'll be joined by the great pianist Martin Bejerano. And this presentation today is really all about what the Frost School's about breaking down silos between music and blurring the lines and exploring what you can find when you paint outside the lines. And so we'll be playing music today by classical composers, by jazz composers, and we'll be exploring it just as our students do at the Frost School. They explore composing and improvisation across genres. And so we hope you enjoy the presentation, and here we go.
Hi, my name is Martin Bejerano, and I'm the head of the jazz piano studio at the highly acclaimed Frost School of Music, University of Miami. I have a pretty big classical background in my own training as well as jazz. And something that a lot of people don't realize is that improvisation, which of course is very important to jazz music, was actually very important to classical musicians as well, hundreds of years ago. Many of the great pianists and composers and performers were also great improvisers, like Bach, Beethoven, and many more. Furthermore, a lot of pieces contained specific sections that were meant specifically for improvisation, such as cadenzas. The two worlds are not as far apart as people might think they are, as you'll see from some of the music that we're going to play for you.
Thank you, Martin. I'm Shelly Berg, and I'm proud to be the dean of the highly acclaimed Frost School of Music. And we're starting today with Johann Sebastian Bach, the great contrapuntalist of the high Baroque period. Bach was, by all accounts, an amazing improviser because he could improvise two, three, and four melodies at the same time. Uncanny. He could improvise canons and fugues. In fact, every Sunday at his church job, like musicians still have, he improvised a fugue at the Sunday morning service. And so we're going to start with one of Bach's inventions. Think about the title, invention. It implies an invention, something you invent, and then you follow it with the left hand and continue to improvise with both hands over it. So it's a two-part invention in D minor by J.S. Bach. Thank you. Ludwig von Beethoven, a pivotal composer at a pivotal time in history, he helped make the transition from the classical period of Haydn and Mozart to the Romantic period. And what was going on in the world was following that, as the city-states were being overrun by adventurous and avaricious rulers. In fact, the rise of Napoleon happened during Beethoven's lifetime. Beethoven was an amazing improviser. He moved from Bonn to Vienna as a young man, and he wasn't composing symphonies yet. He was more composing pieces for him to play and improvise over. He became the toast of Vienna as an improvising pianist, just astounding the entire city. And it wasn't until his hearing started to preclude him from playing as much that he became the symphonist that we know today.
Beethoven wrote 32 piano sonatas, which are some of the most pivotal works for solo piano in piano history, really. The piece that we're going to play is the second movement from one of his most famous sonatas entitled the Sonata Pathétique. This movement has a strikingly beautiful melody that's really just timeless. The first time I ever heard the melody to this piece was actually when I was a young kid, about 3 or 4 years old, and it was performed by the rock band Kiss. You wouldn't usually equate Kiss with Beethoven, but they actually took the main theme from the song and used it as an introduction to a song of theirs entitled Great Expectations. So beautiful music and beautiful melodies transcend genre and transcend style. And as Duke Ellington was famous for saying, there's really only two kinds of music, good and bad.
Thank you.
what Beethoven was to Vienna around the turn of the 19th century, Chopin, Frederick Chopin, was to Paris a few decades later. He was such a formidable improviser that he created a sensation. In fact, there were many contests where he just destroyed the competition. In fact, it was written that he killed all the other pianists dead. And they said, all of Paris is dumbfounded. You can hear this in Chopin's compositions because you can hear him improvising on his own themes as the composition progresses. For instance, in this nocturne, he plays it, he's already improvising on that theme in real time. So literally composing by improvising, and you can hear the development and the improvisation as the piece progresses. Now the piece that we're going to play for you is a mashup. It's based on Chopin and something else, and Martin's going to tell you all about it.
The piece Shelly and I are going to play is by the wonderful Brazilian composer Antonio Carlos Jobim, and is entitled How Insensitive. It's really not a stretch to mix the Chopin with How Insensitive, because actually Jobim stole, for lack of a better word, the melody right out of the beginning of the Chopin prelude. If I play you the original melody from Chopin's prelude, it goes like this. And then if you hear the beginning of How Insensitive, you can definitely hear the similarities. So this is a classic case of two musical styles hundreds of years apart, but sharing harmonic, melodic material, and it's a perfect piece for us to mash up a little bit.
Thank you.
Gabriel Fauré, a French composer of the late 19th century, lived into the 20th century, known for beautiful art songs. His song Après un rêve is one of the most gorgeous things ever composed, and I've had the pleasure of recording that piece. But he also had a very famous instrumental piece that he wrote for piano and then later orchestrated, and it's called Pavane. I knew this piece as a child, and then as I got more and more into jazz, I heard an amazing recording by the great pianist Bill Evans. And he played on this recording with a small orchestra, Fauré's Pavane, in a sort of a Latin-ish style. And it stuck with me ever since. So Martin and I are going to take a turn at this beautiful, beautiful melody by Gabriel Fauré.
Thank you.
Alberto Ginastera was a wonderful Argentinian composer from the mid-20th century. He was very influenced by Argentinian folk music, and you can really hear it in the rhythmic makeup of his compositions, as well as in some of the harmonic schemes that he incorporated as well. The piece that we're gonna play is a wonderful movement from a series of danzas called Danzas Argentinas. We're playing the first movement, which is called Danza del Viejo Boyero, which means Dance of the Old Goat Herder. Just to kind of show you how music can transcend styles and genres and years, there's a great story about the great progressive rock band Emerson, Lake & Palmer, who did a wonderful arrangement of one of Ginastera's pieces. And Ginastera got word of this and actually ended up going to Keith Emerson's house and listening to the recording with him, and he absolutely loved it. So that just goes to show you that this music is really for everybody and is very easily translated in many different styles and in many different ways.
Thank you.
Well, up to now, Martin and I have been playing music by classical composers that lend itself to improvisation, as those composers did, and we've added our own style to it. But now we're gonna move to the Great American Songbook, that treasure trove of material for jazz musicians. Much of the music written for Broadway and film, and one of the great composers was Jerome Kern, who wrote over 700 songs, and many of the most beloved songs that we have in the Great American Songbook. The song that we're gonna play was written for a musical called Roberta that did not survive. This was often the case. The song survived. And this song wasn't even the most famous song in its day from that musical. That honor went to a song called Smoke Gets in Your Eyes.
The Broadway composers from the 1920s and 30s and 40s, such as Jerome Kern, were heavily influenced by classical music and classical composition, especially the Romantic and Late Romantic era composers. Yesterday's by Jerome Kern is no exception. It contains a lot of the harmonic movement and harmonic structures that you find in a lot of Romantic classical composition. If I play just the chords of the piece and kind of leave out some of the more jazzy notes, so to speak, you can definitely hear the influence.
We close our concert today, fittingly, with music of a pianist and composer who composed in both jazz and classical music. I'm speaking of Dave Brubeck, who, as rock and roll was taking over the world in 1959, he had a huge hit on college campuses with his recording of Take Five. Brubeck studied with the French composer Darius Milhaud, and he was so influenced by Milhaud that he named his eldest son Darius Brubeck. Now, you all know a piece by Mozart called the Rondo a la Turk. You can hear some Turkish influence in Mozart music, but wait till you hear what Brubeck did with it. I'm going to let Martin explain that, but for now I'll say thank you for listening to our program, and it's always an honor for me to play with Martin Bejerano.
Really, the name of this piece says it all, Blue Rondo a la Turk. Blue, obviously coming from the blues, which you'll hear toward the middle of the piece when we get more into the improvisational section, where we start playing on a blues form, a traditional blues form, the most popular jazz form. And then there's the Turk or Turkish part of the piece. Although I think Brubeck took it a little bit more in a different direction than Mozart did, pretty much in a more literal direction. Eastern European music is very famous for having mixed meter, using odd time signatures. So they had a lot of music that wasn't necessarily in 4/4 or in 3/4 like most Western music is. They used meters like 9/8 and 11/8 and 13/8 and even other stranger type of meters. This type of music usually used patterns that were based on sets of twos and threes. So in this piece, you'll hear two different versions of that breakup of pattern. The first one is three sets of two, and then a three. So 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. And then the next pattern that he uses is three sets of threes, and that's on this part of the theme. All right, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. This type of music often mixed different patterns because it came from dancing, and the type of dance step was based on the meter that was used. So for example, the three side, since it's a little bit longer, might be used for when you had to jump in a particular dance, and maybe the two side, which was shorter, was for something that was a simple step. So really, this is a fantastic example of blending of many different types of music. Classical music, Eastern European folk music, and of course, jazz. It's been a really great experience for me to play this wonderful music. I want to thank Shelly Berg for inviting me to do this and play with such a fantastic pianist. And I really hope you enjoy this last piece, Blue Rondo a la Turk.